what our salvation. Sin was strong, but the Savior is stronger. Come, let us worship Him. Great was the debt that we owed, and how high was the price of our healing, paid in full by the One who is worthy. Come, let us worship Him. Raised to life with Christ the Savior, in His name a new creation. Now our song will rise, adoring Christ the Lord. Death overcome by the word that was spoken before it was finished. Jesus saves is our song everlasting. Come, let us worship Him. Raised to life with Christ the Savior, in His name a new creation. Now our song will rise, adoring Christ the Lord. Sin was strong, but Jesus is stronger. Our shame was great, but Jesus, you're greater. Sin was strong, but Jesus is stronger. Our shame was great, but Jesus, you're greater. Sin was strong, but Jesus is stronger. Our shame was great, but Jesus, you're greater. Raised to life with Christ the Savior, in His name a new creation. Now our song will rise, adoring Christ the Lord. Now our song will rise, adoring Christ the Lord.
Lincoln's told me to do everything three times this morning, and he didn't tell me to do that once, so.
Can you turn your mic on?
It's on, thank you. Hey, that lets you know that if you make mistakes, you're welcome here. I hope that's what that lets you know. Hey, thanks for coming out to be with us at Twickenham this morning. If you're a guest, welcome, we're glad you're here. If you're traveling, our prayers will be that you'll be safe. If you are looking for a church home, we are always looking for new family members. We're just really, really glad you're here. In fact, one of the things that we wanted to do this morning was welcome some new folks. So I'm going to introduce three families to you. First, James and Mary Miller. Are you guys here? Can you stand so we can give you a hand? Here we go. Welcome, you guys. Glad you're here. Charles and Michelle Thompson. They usually sit over in here somewhere, I think. There we are right there, Charles and Michelle. Glad to have them. And Wanda Hubbard. Wanda, where are you? Wanda Hubbard, where are you? Where are you? There you are in the back. Back there. Awesome. Glad to have these folks. So we want to welcome them. Look them up and say hello to them after our services this morning. That'd be great. You will see a lot of folks wearing pink T-shirts this morning. Those are all Twickenham folks who ran yesterday in the Liz Hurley Ribbon Run. Liz is a news broadcaster here in town that had breast cancer some years ago and sponsors a run every year. And the folks that you see in these T-shirts are a part of Farrah's Village. One of our members, Farrah Rawlings, was diagnosed with breast cancer some weeks ago, and they're surrounding Farrah to love and support her. So let's give all you guys with pink shirts, can you stand up just so we can see how there's a bunch of us in here. You go ahead and stand up, and we're going to give you a hand. There we go. How about that? That's awesome. Give a stand for the reading. Yep. Let's go ahead and everybody stand now and give yourselves a hand just because you're here. All right. And we're going to begin this morning with a reading from God's Word. So let's hear it, and let's rejoice in all that He's going to do among us today.
Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, praise His name, proclaim His salvation day after day.
Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous deeds among all peoples.
For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods.
For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens.
Splendor and majesty are before Him. Strength and glory are in His sanctuary.
We praise Thee, O God, for the Son of Thy love, for Jesus who died and is now God above. Hallelujah, Thine glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, Thine glory. Revive us again. All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Revive us again. All glory and praise to the God of all grace, who has bought us and sought us and guided our ways. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, Thine the glory. Revive us again. Oh, the Lord, our strength and song, highest praise to Him belongs. Christ the Lord, our conquering King, Your name we raise, Your triumph sing. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious One. By His hand we stand in victory, and by His name we overcome. The storms of hell pursue. In darkest night, we worship You. You divide the raging sea. From death to life, You safely lead. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious One. By His hand we stand in victory, and by His name we overcome. All the saints and angels bow, hosts of heaven are crying out, glory, glory to the King, You reign. Praise the Lord, the glorious One. By His hand we stand in victory, and by His name we overcome. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. The Lord shall reign forever. Shall reign forever and ever. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. The Lord shall reign forever and ever. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious One. By His name we overcome. Praise the Lord, our mighty warrior. Praise the Lord, the glorious One. by his name we overcome.
The Lord reigns, let the nations tremble. He sits enthroned between the cherubim, let the earth shake.
Great is the Lord in Zion, he is exalted over all the nations. Let them praise your great and awesome name, he is holy.
You are holy.
You are holy.
And you are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise. I will follow.
I will follow.
I will live.
Lord of lords, he is King of kings, he is mighty God, Lord of everything. He's Emmanuel, he's the great I am, he's the Prince of Peace, who is the Lamb. He's the living God, he's my saving grace, he will reign forever, he is Ancient of Days. He's the Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. He's my Savior, Messiah, Redeemer and friend. He's my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for him.
You are holy.
You are holy.
And you are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy. Standing for Isaiah 53.
Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem.
Be seated as we take our offering. Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. As he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned,
to the Father's will, he took a crown of thorns. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem and reconcile the very ones who nailed him to that tree. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Yes, now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. See, the stone is rolled away. Behold the empty tomb. Hallelujah, God be praised. He's risen from the salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee, praise and honor unto thee.
Man of sorrows, what a name, for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior, bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. God, we come as ruined sinners to proclaim the salvation that we have through the suffering of our Savior and your Son. And we ask that his suffering would not be lost on us as we share this bread together today, his body, to remember that it was broken for us. And we offer our thanks and our praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Guilty, vile, and helpless we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement, can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. God, we come guilty and vile and helpless to be saved by one who was perfect. God, may we remember the blood that flowed as we share this cup that was willingly given on our behalf so that we might not be guilty and vile and helpless, but that we might be sinless and whole and true and pure. Help us to think on that sacrifice as we share this cup together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Lifted up was he to die. It is finished, was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high. Hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glory. Broke through my night, restored exceeding joy. Your grace fell like the rain and made this desert live. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have turned my sorrow into joy. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have turned my sorrow into joy. Your hand lifted me up, I stand on solid ground. Your praise rose in my heart and made this valley sing. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have turned my sorrow into joy. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have turned
my sorrow into joy. This is how we overcome. This is how we overcome. This is how we overcome. You have turned my morning into dancing. You have turned my sorrow into joy. You have turned my morning into dancing. You have turned my sorrow into joy. This is how we overcome.
Amen. Don't be seated. We're going to pray right now. Tim Logan, lead us.
Amen. We love you, God. Only through you can we overcome. And we depend upon you for that. God, I thank you for this church. I thank you for our elders, our staff, for the men of integrity and faith that they are, for their leadership, the way they love us. God, help as they challenge us to be up to those challenges. Help us to love this church and all the good that we can do from it. But God, also help us to get out of these four doors, these four walls, this building. Help us to have eyes that can see hurting people. Help us to have hands that will reach out to help. Help our hearts to be filled with compassion, that we will love generously, and that we will help carry the burdens of others. You are the Lord of the harvest. Help us to walk in your fields, God, and be prepared for the circumstances that you put before us. Help us to walk in oneness with you through the Spirit as we reflect your nature to others. You've not called us to have all the answers, but to draw close to you. God, governments and presidents will come and go, but you are God, and you will always be our ruler. Help us not to be afraid of those who are different from us, but to reach out and share Christian kindness. Share love with them. We have a day of prayer coming up very soon. What a wonderful way to reach out to others and show that we care, that we are concerned, and that we are there to support. Only through your Son, Jesus, we are who we are because of his grace and mercy. And Father, help us to always extend that to others. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
And now you can be seated.
Thanks, Tim. So today's going to be a little different, at least in this part of our time together. We're usually in a series. We just finished one called Deeper. And then next week, we're going to begin a new series called Whatever. It's based on the book of Philippians. That's actually the title of it, Whatever. It's based on the book of Philippians, Joy No Matter What. You may know somebody that's struggling right now with finding joy, because their circumstances are not really conducive to that. Well, the book of Philippians is about how we can have joy no matter what. That's at least what it's about in part. So we'll begin that next Sunday morning. This message is not a part of a series, and it's actually not even a sermon. This is more of a report. So if you're a guest today, a lot of what we're going to be talking about is pretty specific to Twickenham. But that doesn't mean that you wasted a trip. In fact, if I were looking for a church, this is the kind of stuff I'd want to know about and I'd be interested in. So I think even if you're not a part of the Twickenham family, you'll find it useful. And I hope you'll find our candor refreshing. See, what's going on right now in a lot of people's minds is they have no idea what this is about, and they're going, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? So, actually, we're going to talk about, we're going to put up on a screen everybody's sins today. So, we're actually not going to do that. Some weeks ago, we asked our church to participate in a survey. It's called the Transformational Discipleship Assessment, and I just want to unpack some of that feedback for you today. The survey is an instrument produced by Lifeway Research. That's part of the Southern Baptist Publishing Group. And they identified 9 biblical attributes that consistently show up in the life of a maturing Christian. Lifeway produced this assessment by surveying over 4,000 Christians. And I want to run through the attributes for you real quick. There's Bible engagement. Maturing Christians tend to read and study the Bible through the week on a consistent basis. That's correlated with spiritual growth. Obeying God, denying self, that refers to a not my will, but your will be done sort of way of living, a lifestyle. Serving God and others, maturing Christians look to the needs of other people. That actually comes up in the book of Philippians 2, chapter 2. We'll take a look at that this coming week. Sharing Christ intentionally, developing relationships with people who don't know Jesus and sharing the message with them, exercising faith, trust in God even when times are hard, seeking God, maturing Christians are worshiping Christians, and not just on Sundays. Worship is a way of life for them. Building relationships. We're not in this alone. We're not lone rangers or rangerettes. Christianity is a team sport. We're building relationships with each other. Unashamed transparency is the 8th one. That refers to a lifestyle of openness and consistency between our words and our actions. Authenticity is a good way to put that one. And then doctrinal positions. Maturing Christians know what they believe, and what they believe is consistent with Scripture. So those are the 9 categories that the TDA based the survey on. Now I want to remind you of something that's really important here, okay? Nobody knows how you personally responded to the survey. What I'm going to share with you are group results. No, I don't know how you responded to the survey, okay? So if you're thinking about easing out, you don't have to. Nobody knows how you responded. That would be awkward, I think. I mean, this wasn't a question on the survey, but like if it were, the preaching really, really inspires me. Strongly agree, somewhat agree, disagree, strongly disagree. You know, we put that one up there, and then Lisa Vickery, preacher's wife, that strongly disagree. That would be awkward, right? Nobody knows how you responded. So you can relax about that. These are general results. We had 200 completed surveys, which for our size church exceeds the ideal response by 25 points. So we have high confidence in the accuracy of the results. And I just want to thank you for your willingness to provide that feedback. So here's how the survey scored the responses. Those were the categories that they assessed. Now, here's how they scored it. A score of 4 to 5 indicates a response that correlates with consistent spiritual development. So anything north of 4 is good. Okay, it means that that we're consistently positive and growing in that area. 2 to 3.9 is moderate spiritual development, and then anything under 1.9 indicates limited spiritual development. Now, I just want to be real clear. There were 82 questions on this survey. I'm not going to go through all 82 questions today. You engineers in the room who want to get down into the weeds on that can do it on your own time. I'm not a numbers guy, not a numbers cruncher. If somebody asked me, would you rather learn how to do an Excel spreadsheet or use Internet Explorer for the rest of your life, I'd say goodbye Chrome, because I don't want to know. All right? The couple of computer geeks got that. I'm going to give you an aerial view, okay? I'm going to give you about a 10, 15,000 foot view, and then I'm going to tell you two or three ways we're going to respond to the survey results. Okay, so look in your Bibles to Romans chapter 7. Really important set of verses here. Romans chapter 7. This is a passage where Paul exercises some of what the survey calls unashamed transparency. He's just super honest about his struggles. So I love the way the Message puts this. Listen to what Paul writes here. I can will it, but I can't do it. I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to do bad, but then I do it anyway. My decisions, such as they are, don't result in actions. Something has gone wrong deep within me and gets the better of me every time. It happens so regularly that it's predictable. The moment I decide to do good, sin is there to trip me up. I truly delight in God's commands, but it's pretty obvious that not all of me joins in that delight. Parts of me covertly rebel, and just when I least expect it, they take charge. Paul the Apostle wrote that. Paul the Apostle experienced a gap between his convictions and his actions. His heart was in the right place. His habits did not always follow. His beliefs were solid, but his behavior not as consistent. Does that kind of ring true for anybody here besides me and Paul? If I were going to give you a two-sentence summary of this 82-question survey that we took, it would be this. Our head and our heart as a church are in the right place. Our actions don't always reflect that. We have a gap, like Paul. It's not a chasm, but it's not a crevice either. Let me show you what I mean. Just a couple of examples here. Our overall result on doctrinal precision, doctrinal positions, was 4.62. Okay, remember, anything north of 4 is good. That indicates consistent spiritual development. As a church, we know what we believe, and what we believe is consistent with Scripture. We're pretty solid here. And you know, Alexander Campbell would be really upset with us if we weren't, so we're glad about that. That's a good sign. Okay, so that's a solid thing. On sharing Christ, however, our overall result was 2.76. Anything between 2 and 3.9 indicates only moderate spiritual development. Do we believe that sharing Christ is a biblical mandate? Oh, yeah. One of the questions under the category of sharing Christ asks whether we believe we had a personal responsibility to share Christ with our neighbors. You know, if I've got that and you get with, if we have a personal responsibility, our result was 4.45. That's great. But like Paul, there's this gap between our conviction and our action. On a couple of the questions in that category, we scored below a 2. Limited evidence of spiritual development. That's not just a growing edge for us, that's a concern. So we really know what we believe, but we really struggle to communicate that to others. Head, heart in the right place, habits not so much. Here's another example of the gap. One of the categories in this survey is called exercising faith. Basically, it's about trust in God that He is present and active in our lives, even if times are really tough. One of the questions in that category was this: I believe that God has a purpose for all events in my life, regardless of whether I perceive each event as being good or bad. We scored 4.57. Again, north of 4, very solid. Apparently, many of us in this room have been through some really hard times, and we look back on those times and we see that God was at work even in the hard times, and so we've got confidence that He will be at work and available and present in our lives in the future. And yet, under the category of building relationships, we didn't do as well. Well, one question under building relationships read, how often do you personally pray in a group with other Christians? We scored a 1.69. So we trust that God is in control. We've got that. We believe that. And yet we have a hard time connecting spiritually with other believers. And the reason that's an area of concern is because one of the ways God's there for us when times are tough is through other people. So we've got to be able to connect with each other. And one more real quick here. On the statement, a Christian must learn to deny self in order to serve Christ, we scored 4.56. But on the statement, I am intentionally putting my spiritual gifts to use serving God and others, we scored below 4. So when you look at the data across the various categories, you see this really consistent pattern. I call it the Romans 7 dilemma. We know what to do. We want to do it. We don't always follow through. Does that feel familiar to you? I mean, if we're doing that individually, I know what I ought to do. I really want to do it. I struggle to get my actions to catch up with my convictions. I think we feel that personally, and it's showing up in us as a church. That's why what Paul says next in the book of Romans is such good news. You've got the Romans 7 dilemma and then the Romans 8 rescue. He says, with the arrival of Jesus the Messiah, that fateful dilemma is resolved. Those who enter into Christ's being here for us no longer have to live under a continuous low-lying black cloud. A new power is in operation. The Spirit of life in Christ, like a strong wind, has magnificently cleared the air, freeing you from a fated lifetime of brutal tyranny at the hands of sin and death. In other words, our faith in Christ means that even if there's a gap between our beliefs and our behavior, there is not a gap between us and God. Not the slightest interfenestration. That's good news. So when we think about ways to bridge the gap, to bring our hearts and habits into greater alignment, we're not doing that anxiously. Nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. In fact, the security of our relationship with God is precisely what motivates us to want to close the gap between what we believe and how we live. And so let me talk about that for just a little bit, just two or three things that we are working on together. First of all, we have, our church is divided into different councils. And one of our, in terms of our leadership and decision-making process, and one of our councils is the teaching council. It's made up of some shepherds and some staff members who are gifted as teachers and are focused on that. And so the teaching council is going over the data in the survey, and we are asking this question, what do we need to teach? What do our teachers need to be teaching? And the teaching events that we have here on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights and other teaching events that we have, what do we need to be teaching to speak into the weaknesses that we see in the survey? We're looking at passages, at texts of Scripture. We're looking at curriculum that can speak into our weak areas. And we want to equip our teachers to bring the Word of God to bear on those areas where we need to be strengthened. Some of those are doctrinal areas. Some of those are practical kinds of areas. Now, look, we understand, and I think everybody knows this, right, that information is not necessarily the solution to every problem. Their bookshelves and bookstores are full of books that give you information about how to make your life better. Okay, we know that information is not going to solve everything. But we talked about this during the Deeper series when we talked about trying to get closer to God and go deeper with God. You can't do God's will if you don't know God's will. So we've got to instruct to that. We've got to teach to that. And it's not always that you just need the information. Sometimes we know the information. We just don't know how to put it to practical use in our lives. And so some of the teaching that we'll do will be focused not just on here's what God wants. It'll be on here's how we do what God wants. So that's one thing right there. The teaching council is working on developing some materials that can speak into those areas of weakness. Here's the second thing. In December, I'm going to give you a preaching calendar for the 2017 year so you can know exactly what's coming up and know when to skip. Just want to see if you're listening, okay? This is kind of dry stuff here. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to be preaching on and when we're going to be doing that. Last week, the elders and the staff graciously gave me permission to get away for a few days. I went deep into the woods in a cabin, just me and my Bible and my computer and a couple of other books. I did some reading, I did some praying, and I did some planning for the 2017 year about what I'll be preaching on through that year. And I only got anxious one time, late at night. Actually, I got anxious twice. I'll tell you about the other one in a minute, but I got anxious once at about 10:30 at night when I started thinking about clowns in the middle of the woods. It was very uncomfortable. So, not a happy moment there, but I prayed. So here's the thinking behind giving you the preaching calendar. If you know what's coming up, then you can very intentionally be praying about that. You can ask God to bless the preparation of it, and even more importantly, you can ask God to bless the hearing of that message, because the hearing is even more important in my mind than how a message is delivered, is how it's heard by those who hear it. Jesus talks a lot about that. And so you can be praying about that, but here's the other thing you can do. For example, on Mother's Day, we're going to start a series called Good and Messy. It's about family. Okay, that may be about your family, right? Maybe the messy part. But we're going to start this series on Mother's Day, and it's going to run all the way to Father's Day, and we're going to talk about the fact that not every family is going to look like Ward and June Cleaver. Some of us are going to be kind of messy, but we can still be good. There are a lot of stories about families in the Bible that they were kind of messed up, but they were still good families. We're going to look at that. And if you know somebody in your neighborhood or where you work or a buddy at school that could be blessed by something like that, you can begin to pray that God will open doors of opportunity for you to invite them to that particular series. Speaking of you guys, in August, when school starts, we're going to do a series in the book of Daniel. Because Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, all four of those guys and several other people from their demographic there in Israel were literally taken into academic captivity, which is what happens to you when you go back to school every year. You're taken into academic captivity. And we're going to talk about, as we look at Daniel, when school starts, how do you be a person of God? How do you be a young man or young woman of God in an environment that's not always conducive to that? In February, we're going to do a series called God Is. Maybe you know people who are struggling with who God really is and his identity, and is he there? And what's he like if he's there? We'll talk about that. But if you know those things are coming, you can be more intentional about inviting people to come be a part of our family here, and that addresses the weakness of sharing Christ. See, I think we think sometimes that in order to share Christ, I got to take somebody from non-belief all the way to baptism, and that's just not true. You just have to be a part of that process. We are in this together, and everybody brings different gifts to bear, and so maybe you get us to the 5-yard line, and somebody else gets us to the 15, and somebody else gets us to the 50, and somebody takes it all the way, but if we know what's coming, we can invite people just to be a part of that teaching event. So I'll give you a calendar. That's two things. So teaching council, the preaching calendar, and here's the last one. And this is the other time I got anxious, because I really hesitated to tell you about this one. Not hesitated, but I've been nervous about it. I feel like you're going to be a little bit underwhelmed with it, just to be honest. And after I got over the clown thing in the woods, I was sitting there one afternoon, and I was just feeling a lot of anxiety about telling you about this. And then the Lord just went, relax. Tell them about Naaman. And I went, oh, yeah, Naaman. So there's this story in 2 Kings chapter 5 about an Assyrian king named Naaman, N-A-A-M-A-N. And this guy was a brilliant military tactician, just brilliant general. He was like the George Patton or the Dwight Eisenhower or the Norman Schwarzkopf or the David Petraeus of generals. He was just really a brilliant military genius and had been very successful in his campaigns, but he had a problem. He had a disease. He had leprosy. So on one of his campaigns, apparently they had captured some Hebrews, and they brought them back and they made them slaves. And one of them became the maid in Naaman's house. And one day, the little Hebrew maid was dusting the furniture when she just mused aloud, "It's too bad that the general can't go to Israel and meet the prophet. Because if he knew the prophet in Israel, the prophet in Israel could heal the general of his leprosy." And you know, guys, we don't like to go to the doctor, right? We always avoid going to the doctor. Naaman comes home from work, and Mrs. Naaman meets him at the door and says, "You're making an appointment with the prophet in Israel, and you're going tomorrow." And he goes, "Okay." So arrangements are made. Naaman goes to see Elijah the prophet, rides up with his big entourage with a cloud of dust, and waits for the prophet to come out, and nothing happens. Then the door of Elijah's house opens, and out comes the butler. And the butler walks over and says, "Which one of you is Naaman?" And he says, "I'm the general." And the butler says, "The prophet says for you to go dip 7 times in the Jordan River and you'll be healed. You may go." And Naaman is apoplectic at that. Because A, he's the general. And you don't send the butler out to talk to the general. You roll out the red carpet. You have a reception. You have dignitaries there. You have shrimp trees and things to drink. You do all kind of stuff. The prophet comes out and waves his hands in the air and says things in Hebrew. You make a big deal about it. Don't send out the butler. And B, the Jordan is not a river. It's a mud hole. You want to see a river? Come with me to Assyria and I will show you some rivers. C, in fact, I'm headed back to Assyria right now. You can forget this. So Naaman rides off in a huff. I think he's got some older guys with him who are servants. I think they're older because of what they say. Because what one of his servants says to him is the kind of thing that somebody older would know to say. Somebody who's lived a while and has some wisdom. The servant says, "General, a word if I may. If the prophet had come out and asked something grand and epic and spectacular, you would have done it. Because nobody does grand and epic and spectacular better than you. But he didn't. He asked you to do something pretty boring and simple and mundane. So why don't you just give it a try? Because it might work." Okay, this that I'm about to tell you about is sort of like that. And I'm the butler, okay? In January, we are going to renew our commitment to our Sunday morning adult teaching ministry, otherwise known as Sunday school. We're going to renew our commitment to that. We're going to renew the mission of our adult Sunday morning teaching ministry. We're going to even rename it, that whole program. And we're going to ask you to recommit to it. Some of you, we're going to ask to commit to it for the first time. And here's what we're talking about specifically. We're asking you not just to commit to attending a class. We're asking you to commit to a group of people, to commit to one specific group of people, that you are going to journey with those folks wherever God takes you as a group, and that you're going to be there for each other. Not just people who attend the same class, but people who are committed to each other to help us make it through walk with God. We're going to ask you to be consistent in your attendance on Sunday mornings to that group. I know that there are going to be times when you're gone. We got family out of town. We've got business that sometimes takes us out of town. We go on vacations. But we're going to ask you to when you're here, to be here. And be active in the life of that group. Not just come, sit, get, and go, but come and really use your gifts, however God has gifted you, in some way to actively bless the people in that group, knowing that they will be using their gifts to actively bless you. Talking more and more about that as we get closer to the end of the year, but that's what our goal is going to be in January, to really raise the bar on our commitment. We think that will address one of the concerns that the survey showed up, that we struggle to build closer relationships. And I got to tell you, in this culture and in what this culture is becoming, listen to me on this, We are not going to make it if we don't make it together. If we don't have close relationships, we're not going to survive. So we have got to get into each other's lives and be there for each other. This is a really good place for me to say to you how blessed Lisa and I feel to be here. When we heard a couple of years ago that you guys were beginning to look for a minister, and then that our names were on the table, excited about that, because this church has a reputation, and it's a really good reputation. Has a reputation of a church that both embraces and extends grace. And you know my story, you know I needed that, and you gave it. So we are really, really blessed to be here and look forward to what we can do together, not because of what we do, but because of what God does through us, not because of who we are, but because of who He is. Thanks for listening to all this detail, hard stuff. God's going to bless it. I know He will. Pat Taylor's going to lead us in a prayer. Pat, why don't you come up while we finish up here to lead us. If you still have your bulletin, would you be sure and look in that, because there's a lot of really important information in there that folks have taken the time to organize and put out, and you need to know what's coming up. So be aware of all that's in there. Pat, in a prayer, this will be our final prayer. Let's go ahead and stand while Pat leads us, okay?
Let us pray together. Dear God, we just thank you for the fact that you are our God, and that you watch over us as we do our walk through this life, and that we ask you to bless us in a special way as we start planning for the new year. We know, Lord, that there could be a lot of changes coming, but most of all, that we need to grow closer to you and extend your love to others around us. Help us, Lord, if we plan to do that as a church, as a group of people here, and help us to open our hearts and our minds in our lives to others, that they might see Christ living in us. Bless us today as we go out. Help us to always continue to put you first in our lives. I pray in Christ's name.